can't lie to me because I'm gonna see right through you. All right, so today I'm gonna do a couple of things. Did we get it going?
Yes.
Okay, hi everybody. Today we're gonna do a couple of things. One is I'm gonna share with you my story. And if you can't tell already, I've done this before. So I'm hoping that I do a really good job so that you get something out of it and that I am more of like a mirror for you to see inside your own life. So that you don't walk out of here and be like, yes, I know all about Andy Waddle, my life is so much better now, this is awesome. But that you can apply some of the things that you hear that I've been through to your own experiences. So that you can walk out and know more about who you are. That's what I'm hoping to accomplish there. The second thing that I want to do is I want to teach you about suicide, the stigma revolving around suicide, and an actual plan, a three-step action plan for you to do with a friend or a loved one if you think they're in that mental space of thinking of suicide, so that you have a tool that you can use. It's called QPR. Wow, this is awesome. I didn't really have all these boards when I was young. Okay, QPR. Can anyone guess what it stands for? QPR? Any ideas? That's my turn. It's question, persuade, refer. So who's heard of CPR? Everyone should be raising their hand. Okay, so you've heard of CPR, right? So you're gonna learn a QPR, which is the three-step thing that you do in a mental health crisis. And I think the statistics show us that we are more likely to come across someone in a mental health crisis in our life than a heart attack. So that's what you're gonna learn. I hope you take a lot out of that. And then you're gonna have a chance to ask lots of questions. Pick my brain, share what you wanna share. I can even, you know, give you some advice afterward if you have something that a situation you're in. Let's meet afterward and you can check in on that. So let's go way, 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 way back in time, because I'm really not that old, but I am a lot older than I used to be. I was born in the mountains of Western Maryland, and so I am not a Californian. I'm not quite sure exactly. I know San Francisco's north, Los Angeles is south, and I'm somewhere in the middle. So I was raised in a pretty stable home, you know, like a in the sense that it was like mom, dad, country home, private school, two older brothers that were overprotective. I had to wear a uniform to school, so I had those little like pull-up socks and the buckle shoes, horseback riding lessons, just this real kind of this neat, structured life. My dad was really successful. He was a businessman. He was really good at what he did, and he was so good at what he did that he was never home. He was always at work. And I remember when I was 3 years old thinking, is he like a shadow? I've heard of him, but I never see him. And that had a really big impact on me as a little child. I perceived his absence as my fault. That it must have to do with something with my worth. And as I got a little older, you know, I was always active and I was always doing things, and I decided that I wanted to take a ballet class. Many young girls go through that, right? Or young boys. I want to take a dance class, Mom. And it's, in particular, I wanted to take a ballet class. So I took a ballet class, and I remember something just clicked when I did ballet. Have you ever done something in your life, even for the first time, and it just clicks with you? It could be art, it could be music, it could be dance, it could be anything. And it's almost like I came home. I was really good at ballet. In fact, I was so good at ballet that within 2 years, I was auditioning for pre-professional classical ballet schools around the country. So I auditioned for a school in Virginia, and I got in, and I moved away from home at 14 years old. How cool is that? 14, I get a dorm room, I got roommates, I got my own checkbook. You know, endless possibilities there. And I felt like, well, what's better than feeling like you're with a group of people who understand you? We were all doing the same thing. We were all doing what we loved. We were all working towards the same goal, which was to be professional dancers. I remember dancing 7-8 hours a day, 6 days a week, auditioning for a ballet company. So as soon as I graduated high school, I would be picked up. It's a lot like that in sports too, you know, you're scouting out players before they even graduate from high school. Well, that's the way it is in the dance world as well. It had a really big impact on me and my self-esteem, my self-worth, and the thing that really brought that together was that my dad, he came to every show. He would come down to my dance school 3 weekends a month to take me and my friends out to dinner, paint my dorm room blue. I don't even remember why I picked blue, but I did. Those little things, he showed up and I felt like I was not invisible anymore. And that's what created that belief in me that I was what I did. A dancer was who I was, and that's all I was. In 1994, after a really hard show, I was an understudy, and then for Swan, we were in, you know, anybody heard of it, Swan Lake? Good, yeah. One of the older swans, she got a stress fracture in her ankle the night before the show, of course. So I had to do all her parts and all my parts. So instead of icing and stretching and doing all my self-care stuff the day of the show, I was rehearsing. And it was an awesome show. It was amazing. It was probably one of the best I'd ever had. But unfortunately, I woke up the next morning and I couldn't move. I was in extreme pain. They sent me to the best orthopedic doctor in Washington, D.C. I remember Petros Bosman from the Royal Ballet. He was my teacher, my mentor. I was his star, and he was like, fix her. I need her back on the dance floor as quickly as possible. But unfortunately, the news from the doctor wasn't good. I had degenerative disc disease, arthritis in my spine. I had 3 herniated discs in my lower back, which means they were all smashed together. I was told that I had the spine of a 4-year-old, and I was only 17. And I will never forget the moment that the doctor turned around and said the words, "You will never dance again." And I remember that moment as a physical sensation of something inside of me breaking. And I know some of you in here know what that feels like. Can identify with that. So I packed up my dorm room, I moved back home, my dad went back to work, and I was invisible again. I had to adjust to normal, typical life. Not only did I lose my identity, but I lost the relationship I had with my father at the time. I found myself in another doctor's office being casted for a brace that would fit from the bottom of my ribs to the top of my hip bones. And it had a large Velcro strap in the middle. It's like a very tight, hard corset. And I'd have to wear it every day, all day for 6 months so that my spine could heal. But with a body that went from moving and longing to move to completely immobilized, it was almost like I was frozen in time. And that's what happened with my through that traumatic pain. It was frozen in time. And I buried it. Because in my mind at the time, I didn't know that I had developed a mental health disorder, so my brain could not process the trauma of that. So I blamed myself. A lot of people told me, just go find something else to do. You're talented, be an actress. You know, just be on stage, just don't do ballet. But they did not understand that I was suffering from grief and from loss. So, God, don't you love high school? People are so nice, aren't they? So kind and sweet. I got the whole, what are you doing back here? Because all my friends, you know, they were like, Amy's the ballet star, bye-bye, have a nice life. So what are you doing back here? What was it like having your own apartment? It was amazing. And then, why don't you dance again? Or this one is even better. Knock on my brace. At the time, there was this really, really cheesy band called Ace of Base. Okay? He's laughing because he knows there. So they called me Ace of Brace. That's what I'm famous for, apparently. So my nickname was Ace of Brace. I'm sure they meant well, but to me it was like, could you point out any more of the differences between me and you? See, their issues, they were like, oh my God, who am I gonna hang out with this weekend? And I'm like, oh my God, what am I gonna do for the rest of my life? I had already had my career. You know, I was done. At 17, I was retired, I was done. So what the hell am I gonna do with myself the rest of my life? I had a really hard time connecting with my peers. The depression set in. Because when you bury it alive, and then it comes back up in different ways. That's how we get signs and symptoms of mental health conditions. It pops up in different ways. I hated myself. I loathed myself. I blamed myself because I wasn't good enough to handle it. So many athletes get injured. So many don't make it. And sometimes they blame themselves because they weren't good enough, when really it had nothing to do with their talent or their dedication to their craft. It's just our bodies are breakable when you bend them in half like that, especially, right? Football players go through it all the time. You get them kicked out of you, you know? It's really hard for your body to keep going, but I blamed myself for that. And then there was a voice inside my head that said, you know what, Amy? If you could just stay thin, you could stay happy. You know, if you could just keep your dancer body, because that is something that you can control. Everything else in life is out of control. You can't control if your dad's gonna pay attention to you. You can't control that. You can't make someone show up for you, right? It's their choice. I couldn't make my friends understand me, but I could make my body look a certain way. I believed the voice that said, if you just hold your body together, if you just hold that dancer physique, you'll be happy. I did everything I could to not develop. I did everything I could to resist puberty. Believe me. I went back to high school and all my friends had filled out, you know? They had like matured. And here I was just kind of like flat, you know, indentations. And just, I looked really different than them, but I didn't want to look like them, but I wanted to be like them. Oh, that makes any sense. So I starved myself. I became obsessed with diet. See, diet said, hey, look, if you do this meal plan, you'll be happy. They never sell them that you'll be sad, right? You'll feel like a failure if you do this diet. No. What they tell you is you'll be a failure if you don't do this diet. And I believed that crap. I believed it. And you know what helped even more is that I felt worthless because of my mental health condition. I had depression. I had anxiety. I had a really hard time connecting. I remember my friends, like, they go through high school breakups. You know what those are. You know what those are like, right? You go through a high school breakup, and they just go get a new boyfriend. Me? I wanted to kill myself. Because my mind could not process any form of that intense rejection emotion. At 19 years old, I started having really bad panic attacks. I couldn't hide it anymore. It started coming out through, you know, like, just tears being, you know, found in the hallway in my house by my brother, feeling like I was dying. That was the first time I went into a psychiatric hospital. I spent a week there, and I realized that I was angry. I was angry at my dad. They put me on some medicine. They gave me a treatment plan, a piece of paper that said, you know, go to counseling, go to do this, and good luck. And I did that. I didn't want anybody to know I was in counseling. I didn't want anyone to know I was on medicine. I didn't want anyone to know I went to the hospital. Not even my fiance at the time. I didn't want him to know because I wanted to keep it separate from the rest of my life. Well, that doesn't work very well, just so you know. I continued to become more and more obsessed with diet and exercise. I would get compliments. I love your body, you look so amazing, you're so dedicated, you never miss a day at the gym. And it's like, yes, reinforce my eating disorder. Yes, I am successful. If I do this, I am successful. What they didn't know was that I was trying to kill myself. I was trying to damage myself because my eating disorder said I was worthless. That voice was all I could hear from the moment I woke up to the moment I went to bed, and it told me to write everything down, and it told me to weigh again, and I listened because I was like its slave. You can't survive for very long on cigarettes and coffee. I'm living proof. Because what happened was, by the age of 24, I was at work, and I just collapsed in the bathroom. They found me, my coworkers. They took me to the emergency room. They hooked me up to a bunch of like tubes and sticky patches. They tested my heart. And I remember looking up at the ceiling and thinking, man, I am never going to be skinny. I'm in a hospital bed. And I'm worried about my weight. Eating disorders are mental illnesses. Nobody chooses to do that to themselves. The ER doctor walks in with his bedside manner and his little clipboard, and he says, okay, so you got two choices. You could keep going like you're going and you could die, and you're 24 years old, or you could get help and you could live. And I remember going, those are my two choices? And I was pissed. It's like, isn't there anything else? Come up with something else. Life and death? And I remember my best friend was standing on the left of me, and I was holding her hand, and I looked at her, and that's when I was like, something inside, I was like, okay, I'm gonna do this. I wanna face this. Because there's something inside me that doesn't want this thing to win. And somehow the desire to move forward with my life outweighed the fear of getting better. So I flew across the country from Delaware to Arizona. And I had no idea where Arizona was. Absolutely no clue. People told me it was really, really hot. Be careful. It's really, really hot. It was December, just before Christmas. And I remember they were in the pool. And I had gone off the plane, and I had like scarves and hats and gloves because it was like 32 degrees where I had just left. Huge shock on the system. And I remember the third day in treatment, I called my mom and I said, Mom, I changed my mind. I don't want to be here anymore. This isn't going to work. And all these people have problems. They're the sick ones. Man, I'm okay. These people have real issues. She was like, Amy, it's too late now. So I spent 3 months inpatient, going all the way back and trying to grieve the loss of dance. I didn't know how to do that. I needed to be given a safe space. I was also given an official diagnosis. Bulimia and bipolar 2 disorder. The bulimia did not surprise me. It was kind of obvious what I was going through. It was the bipolar 2 disorder that was a shock. I'm like, what is that? Bipolar. Is that like, do I have to go to a loony bin or something? Like, am I going to be in a coat with the straps? Like, what's going on? Nobody had talked about that before. I didn't know, because nobody talked about it, that my family has mental illness in genetics. And I also didn't know that mental illness can form from a traumatic event. So I had a lot of circumstances that layered. And when we get to QPR, you're going to notice there are circumstances in people's lives that can intersect, that can actually start a mental health condition at any age. So I was put on medicine, and I said, okay, I've got this thing called bipolar. I'll just live my life with bipolar then. And I knew that's why I couldn't handle life back then. That's why I had so much shame. That's why I battled those racing thoughts. So what that did, my diagnosis for me created a space between me and my illness. And that actually helped me. Because then I knew, well, this is something else outside of me that I can fight. This isn't like, oh, I'm weak and insecure, I'm working on myself. No, it was I'm gonna live mentally well outside of this thing, this illness, that is treatable. So I went on medication, I went into the right counseling, I got a great support system, I was discharged, decided to stay in Arizona, I didn't want to go back to Delaware, I just wanted to start fresh and clean. And doesn't it feel good to just start over sometimes? It's not always a bad thing, right? Just leave the old memories behind, start yourself over. But I also had to bring all my issues with me, though. Those came with me in my backpack. 1 year later, I relapsed. Hard. Worst relapse I'd ever experienced. And I already had 3 months of treatment. Man, I felt so much like a failure. I can't even do recovery right. I remember feeling that. I can't even do this medicine, taking my medicine thing right. Because my brain keeps telling me, you're fine, you don't need that medicine. With bipolar disorder, it's very common. Once you start taking your medicine for a while and you start feeling really good, you're like, oh, I don't need the medicine. So you go off the medicine. And my family's like, don't go off your medicine. Don't. So I relapsed hard. And I was in and out of relapses for about 10 years. 10 years I fought with my bipolar. To understand what it meant to have it. To understand how to tell people I had it. To actually accept that it wasn't going to go away. To this day, I can tell you now, after years and years and years, my bipolar disorder has in part made me who I am. Because I know what it looks like to live in complete darkness. So I don't take for granted a good day. And I now can help people who know what darkness looks like too, and remind them of the light. Because you have to. We have to do that for each other, or no one else will. It's so important. So unfortunately, in 2011, something traumatic happened to me. How much time do we have?
1 minute.
Okay. When's class over?
Class is over at 12, but if
you want to 11. Okay. Okay. So 2011, my back went out. Basically a relapse of the spinal injury. And that created, all that physical pain actually brought up the emotional pain associated with the injury. You know that stuff I talked about that was buried? It came back. And it was overwhelming. It was like a rogue wave of emotion. It just knocked me right off my feet. I had a 3-year-old little girl who loved her mommy. I was successful in my work, a husband who adored me, and just my feet got swept right out from under me. And I didn't want to live anymore. I was like, I'm done. I'm done. I can't do this. I literally can't do this. So I was standing in my condo one afternoon all by myself, pacing around, pacing back and forth, because I knew it was time. I knew it was time. My brain was telling me, there's no other answer. You can't do this. I ended up walking in front of the refrigerator and looking and seeing a hotline magnet. A hotline magnet. I did not put that hotline magnet there. And something inside my brain said, call. And I picked up the phone and I called. And this dude answers the phone. He's like, hello? Hey. How can I help you? What's going on with you? And I talked to him. And I remember hearing his voice was like the only lifeline keeping me connected to the real world. Because I was so disconnected from reality. And that's what happens when somebody is suffering from suicide. It's not that they don't want to tell you, it's that they can't tell you. And so if you ask the question, you're the one building the bridge for them to walk out of isolation. You've got to ask the question if you think somebody's thinking of suicide. So guess what he did on the phone with me? He asked me, you know, are you thinking of suicide? What are you planning to do? Are you planning to hurt yourself right now? He persuaded me to not do anything stupid. I mean, don't do anything to hurt yourself. Can you promise me while we're on the phone that you won't do anything to hurt yourself? And so I did. Promised him. He talked me into going to my mom's house, which would be a safe place. I did that. He did what now I know to be QPR. He asked me the question. He persuaded me. He persuaded me to get help. And he referred me to help. And that was really pretty cool. Quite amazing is that now I'm a QPR instructor. And I teach other people how to do that. So let's talk about QPR. By the way, I did move on and forward with my life. I became a professional speaker, became a trainer. I live on my medicine every day. I have healthy respect for my mental illness. As long as it plays fair with me, I play fair with it. So QPR, let's talk about that in a nutshell. It's very simple, actually. If you want to write this down, Q is question, P is persuade, refer is R. Here's not to ask the question. You're not thinking of suicide, are you? Now, why wouldn't anyone want to answer that honestly?
Sounds judgmental.
Yeah. It's like you're not going to do anything stupid, are you? Yep, that's me. I'm stupid. Yeah, sign me up for that list. Right? So we want to not use sarcasm. You also, because the answer to that question is really important because it's going to affect how you go from there, you've got to ask the suicide question. Not, have you been feeling down lately? Or, you know, things like that. Don't beat around the bush. Ask direct question, are you thinking of suicide? And say it like, you know, sometimes when people are going through this, they think of suicide. I wonder if maybe you're thinking of suicide. All right? Try to form some questions in your mind that you would most likely ask someone. Have a plan for yourself. Know what you would ask. Or maybe it's, what would you prefer someone ask you? And use that. Okay. Persuade. We're all persuasive. Much, much more than we realize. I can talk anyone into anything. Specifically my husband. Oh yeah. I don't want to see that movie. I'm going to persuade him to see the chick flick. And I'm so good at it. Or my kid. She wants to go to Panda Express again. So here I go, I kick into persuasive gear. Oh, but babe, remember last time when you got the orange chicken? And it was kind of squishy and it cost $7? Let's go over to McDonald's because I'm in the mood for a filet of fish. And she's like, okay, great, yeah, me too. Doom, done, persuaded. You can persuade anyone. Dude, you matter so much to me. I need you here. I care about you. Who would walk your dog? Saturday mornings mean a lot to me when we have coffee. Come on, let's keep doing this, man. Let's work through this. Let's go talk to someone, right? That's all that is persuade. You got to give people hope. You got to tell people they matter. We don't hear that enough. We don't hear, hey, man, you matter to me. You are so important. You know what? You're good enough. Those are the words that people need to hear sometimes. And refer. You could, if you can see their body is in crisis, they're crying, you know that they're like, they have an immediate plan, you can tell there's immediate danger, walk them to the counseling office. Walk them to safety. Go to their house. Intervene. Do not assume that they won't hurt themselves, or do not assume that they were going to call the hotline by themselves. Who has a phone? Take it out. All right, there's some really, really, really good apps out there. I want you to take a look at them. I'm just gonna write one on the board so you guys can have time for questions. Jason Foundation. If you have been asleep for the past 15 minutes and you did not hear a dang word I said, you log onto that app, you'll have everything you need. Now, I would prefer that you remember what I say because it makes me feel good about myself. But just in case, Jason Foundation, it's in the App Store. And it literally says, you know, click if you want to ask your friend, click. Actually, the words to say, click how to refer, click where to go for help. All right? Elisa passed out cards. There are text lines now. Who makes phone calls? Who picks up the phone anymore, right? So you text. You can actually text the crisis line now. And they text back and you can have a conversation. How cool is that? So much easier to access sometimes than picking up the phone and giving the courage to actually say the words to somebody, right? All right, so we've gone over my story. There's much, much more, but I wouldn't bore you with that. We've gone over some basic suicide prevention steps. I try to put in some mental health education in my story, like where suicidal thoughts may come from, circumstances in people's lives. A lot of times, you know, again, the truth is that if the thought has already crossed your mind that your friend may have thought about suicide, most likely it's already crossed your mind. All right? So you asking the question is bringing it up, and they're going to be relieved. Suicide is the second leading cause of death in young people 10 to 24. The second leading cause of death. Suicide does not happen without warning. The majority of the time, there are signs and symptoms. And again, Jason Foundation app is a great resource. The Teen Line app, or Teen Line that you have, is a great resource. If you know someone who may, could possibly have thought about suicide as an option, please call that hotline and tell them about it, and they will help you work through what to do next. All right, let's open it for questions, because we have 10 minutes. Questions?